Do I get started now?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, cool. Well, my name is Neal. My email is on the slide. Thank you all for coming to this talk about Dotfiles. Dotfiles are a deeply personal thing. Looking at other people's Dotfiles has been an educational but kind of weird experience. So I'll go ahead and just jump right into whatever it was I prepared. So I'll start with background. I'm not going to start with Dotfiles specifically. I'm going to start with life hack, which is actually a word in the dictionary. It's a strategy or technique adopted in order to manage one's time and daily activities in a more efficient way. The phrase in the Google Index first appeared in the 1880s in the life of P.T. Barnum. This is just so weird that I had to include it. And it's about hack Barnum putting down an L. So anyway, if you go to my second favorite search engine and type in life hack, you got something completely different. Get people putting Skittles into watermelons and whatever that stuff is. So I'm not talking about this at all. So life hack as a word was originally coined by a guy, Daniel O'Brien, in 2004 at a similar community talk in San Francisco. It got picked up by Cory Doctorow and republished on the blog CoinJoin. And it was originally a survey of the tech secrets of alpha geeks. And so I've included the entire list of the people that responded to his email. So you've got Jamie Zawinski, who's one of the programmers on Netscape. You've got Eric S. Rand, who wrote The Bizarre and the Cathedral in the 90s. Nat Torkin, Tim Brad Templeton, DFF. We've got Guido Van Rossum, who created Python. Cory Doctorow was in there, Tim Brad O'Reilly. And I would say his general findings were pretty interesting, at least to me. So all of those people were typically working in shells, usually bash. They all kept their to-dos in a plain text file, to-do.txt. They kept logs full of notes and did a bunch of stuff with RSS. And there was kind of a specific focus on what called dark code. They're like these little shell scripts you write to do something, and then they're kind of too trivial to like be worth sharing. But you got to take a look at these and so here's a good example of what you would call dark code. It's log.perl. What it does is you type log.perl, and it opens up your text editor in the appropriate folder, and then it goes into your log, just like that. I've written all written this kind of stuff before. It's just little throwaway shell scripts that sit on your path. But to give some context around his findings, this was early 2004, it was a long time ago. The Linux kernel had just switched over to 2.6.0, which was going to be kind of the stable version of Linux for a long time until it hit it went to 3.0 for the 20th anniversary, something like that. So there was no Git. If you were using version control at all, it was probably Subversion or CVS. There was Mozilla Phoenix. It hadn't been renamed to Firebird yet because Phoenix was taken, and then it was not renamed from Firebird to Firefox because Firebird was already taken. There was no Gmail back then, so people tended to have a lot of specific stuff for managing email. Ubuntu had not shipped yet, so that was due in October. Your Emacs person in port mode had not yet hit the mainline. It was being run out of the guy's university server at that point. So that's early 2004. At that point, I was a sophomore in college. So I do want to plug this guy's book real quick because I think he does a it's kind of an interesting story of connecting the dots between that early talk that O'Brien did and then how did we end up at the 5-minute crafts video. Because there's a lot of weird stuff in the middle, and he gives an interesting philosophical critique of, is this a good idea? Like, should people be A/B testing their Tinder profiles? Is that ethical? There's a lot of good discussion in there. It's an open access book, so you can read it online. And one of the things that he points out is that burnout is now in the DSM. That's an officially recognized, psychiatric disorder. And probably, as these ideas have gotten mainstream, they've probably been a net positive, but not for everyone. So that's probably all I'm going to say about that part. But I am a data scientist, and so I have a specific statistical critique of how he conducted that study. So in 2004, there was no good way for him to directly observe how people are doing their work. And so in that context, he really just had to ask people. He sent out an email blast of 100 people, people that he knew. They're all in San Francisco for the most part. We would tend to call that a convenience sample, not like a randomized sample, right? He had a very small sample size. He only got 14 responses back. There's a huge non-response bias, so 14 out of 100. Honestly, in the context of online advertising, we kill for 14% sometimes, but it's still not great, and you're trying to be scientific about it. So it's pretty limited to qualitative conclusions at that point. So I mean, it was a great study for kind of introducing the words and getting people to think about it, but would you really want to generalize from the people that wrote back to him to this is how we should work? I don't know. But there's been a lot of changes since then that I think make it interesting to revisit the idea. So the first thing would be what I would call social coding, which would be decentralized version control systems, specifically GitHub. You get free hosting and it's public by default. This is pretty much the default way that people are coding these days. At least in my experience, we now teach Git to teenagers, and that they actually learn that versus when I was in undergrad, I had to learn that stuff on the street when I finally got a job, And so the second thing that's kind of changed that goes with that is what I would call configuration as code, and this is coming out of kind of the DevOps. People use the word transformation. I think that's a little strong. Since like 2010 or so. And the idea there is you can check your settings into Git. You can like configure your entire application and treat it as source code. So I love me a good syllogism. So if we put those together, if coding is social and configuration is code, then you get social configuration. And social configuration is, if I would try to define it, it's the practice of putting in code your real world, actual personal preferences, settings, and workflows, and then sharing and being shared to in that kind of live process over time. You can buy that? Mm-hmm. I like the syllogism. I don't know if that can make the jump to all this stuff. And so specifically, so this is Danny O'Brien's GitHub. If I want to know how he works, like, I just click on the Dotfiles repo. Like, GitHub even has some nice stuff that tells you that it's mostly Emacs list. I think he's an Emacs user. So if we wanted to define Dotfiles, do people know what these are? They've seen them at least when they do an ls-a. It's all those hidden files in your folder, home folder. Those are the plain text configuration files for your shell, your text editor, all that stuff. Maybe if you use Python, you have some preferred Python packages you want to load up. Lots of good stuff. So another thing that I would point out is that configuration is kind of like the missing half of how software is developed in a lot of ways. So there's this great post on Medium, failed effort to get paid for an open source project. It links to something where someone had added some extra log into his product to send back error messages to his thing. Someone else didn't like it. I think that's a common enough occurrence. What I thought was super interesting is if you scroll down that thread, you can see that GitHub is linked back, that in his shell configuration, he has disabled that logging by default. And this is a super interesting kind of case of where this configuration is happening. Maybe use call it dialogue with the development. For, if you want to look at the source code for Unix back in the 1970s, you can go on GitHub and look at System 5 and read that source code. But how people were actually using it back then, all of the configuration and that kind of stuff is generally gone. This is kind of a case where we get to see both sides of that conversation and have the documentation and inside GitHub issue about what people thought about all this logging, right? It's quite possible that every single user he has turns this thing off, and it's basically dead code that lives there. If all you looked at was that source code, you never knew that. And so I would also add that similar to life hacks, you know, there's both a positive aspect to this about where you're describing what it is people are doing and then ignoring it. So my general idea here is I was going to find all the .file repos on the web, clone them all somehow, pull out features is what we tend to call it, extract signal from it somehow, analyze that data, and then turn that into a talk. I think that was the master plan a couple months ago. That was harder than it sounded. So I'll talk about that. So if you want to start finding all these things, a great place to start is Reddit. So there is a subreddit on there called Dotfiles. People just post all their links to their different repositories. It turns out if you want to automate this stuff, you don't want to go through the Reddit API because it makes it difficult to work with history. So there is another website called pushshift.io that offers a nice REST API into all of the Reddit history on Earth. So you can set up a query to that and get all of them back. And so what I started seeing was basically four platforms that were used most commonly. So you have GitHub, didn't surprise me. GitLab, did not surprise me. Bitbucket surprised me a little bit. That was around 3% of the sample. And then a bunch of independents, which is kind of neat. So my inclusion criteria for a particular repo to get into this study, it needed to be named .files exactly. There's a bunch of variations of that. There's a bunch of people that, have, these are my .files, there are many like them, but these ones are mine. That didn't make it into this study, just for time and for data QA reasons. How do you find all these things on GitLab? GitLab was the best one to work with. It has a REST search API, so you can just use wget, give me a list of all the repos named exactly .files, and it comes back with some JSON. You dump it through JQ, and you're done. So the entire workflow is on this slide. If you have any comments about this, so 3,600 hits on GitLab. Bitbucket is probably the least user-friendly. They have no official search API or any public-facing way of actually searching all of Bitbucket. But they have a secret search webpage, which I've linked to. So if you ever find yourself needing to search that website, you can. It's bitbucket.org/repo/all. And what you can do is you can just wget the HTML loop over the pagination, grab out the URLs, and then clean it up from there. One of the things that I hadn't planned on, though, is that Bitbucket actually supports multiple BCSs, so they support both Git and Mercurial, which made downloading the cloning the repos out of it a little more involved. But 2,200 hits, not bad. GitHub was a little more challenging. They've recently deprecated their REST API to move everything over to GraphQL, which I had never worked with before. And a couple annoying things, they limit you to 1,000 hits per search. It will truncate the rest of the results. But what you can do is you can loop over each day and get all the repos for each day and do it that way. So it took about an hour to pull this list of repos. Their API specifically does not include forks. So if someone clicked the fork button, that's not included. I'm okay with that. But what I would call shadow forks are where someone had done that and then pushed to a new repo without clicking the fork button. So those repos are in there. And that's 99,000 hits, going all the way back to 2009. So at this point, our sample size, instead of 14, we're at about 105,000. So we've got five orders of magnitude bigger than the original study that I thought was really interesting. And then there's some indies. These are typically using Git, which is a self-hosted GitHub clone. It's open source. It's quite nice. I recommend if you find yourself wanting to have your own GitHub, it seems like a pretty good option. And you can search for these using Google. So just use inurl.explore/repos. That's their URL schema, and you can find a bunch of these. But there's not a lot of repos out there, actually. So there's still the git.org, which had 9 hits. There's a git.dotfiles.sh, which ironically had no matches, and then there's SourceUp, which had 28. Many, many more of these. It seems like for the most part, if you have all of these, you also have a GitHub account, and so you're mirroring them between the two. And so things that weren't included were Launchpad, which uses the VCR VCS. It had 90 hits, but I don't know how to use VCR. And similarly with Dart, 70 hits. So those 107 people didn't make it into the study, but still got under 5,000. So then we have files full of URLs, now what? Basically, I just catted that through the parallel programming into GitHub with a little bit of shell scripting around it to make it work with, you know, 50% of Bitbucket were actually Mercurial repositories, for all sorts of issues where sometimes it would just hang. So if that hangs, if it's empty, GitHub has issues if it's it's a private repository. It's unclear to me how those private repositories got into my search results in the first place, but that's okay. There's an environment variable you can use to turn it off, and then it'll just die right away instead of hanging and waiting for the test. I will also mention the new Parallel. This is fantastic software. It's a drop-in replacement for XArgs. Only it gives you progress bars. So I ended up watching this progress bar for the better part of 3 weeks. So that's a reassuring thing to have. So that is the how-to part of this talk. I hope that wasn't too dry. But if you guys want to go out and do a similar thing, you could. Maybe there's other things other than dot files that you want to clone a couple hundred times. But the feature extraction part is more about how do we find the interesting things in there. We've got 100,000 folders full of people's random stuff that they felt like saving. So my first idea there was to use this product called Hound that came out of Etsy, and it's supposed to do a local version control system and indexing view using kind of the same algorithm that Google Code Search used to do. And it came with like a simple like React front end. So this is fantastic. It turns out it did not scale up to 100,000 repos quite as nicely as I hoped. So there's lots of issues like that. So then you kind of go, well, best thing I found out there didn't work now. But, so the second idea is to kind of roll my own. Wanted to not reinvent the wheel too much. I had kind of a worse is better attitude. Since I'm a data scientist, I'm willing to do just about everything up until the point where I have to like spin up EMR clusters on Amazon or whatever. So if I can avoid doing Spark, I'm going to lean towards that. I really only had a couple of requirements. So no false negatives. If there is a search and that thing is in the repo somewhere, it needs to come back. If there's false positives, fine. I can filter it out later. But no false negatives. It needs to be reasonably high throughput or IO bound. So it's spinning the disk as fast as possible, solid state, so it's not spinning. It needs to be non-flaky or fault tolerant. Like I said, I'm running these things for weeks at a time. I don't want it to die in the middle of the night and I have to start all the way over. If I were to put this into 80s rock opera lyrics, so no false negatives means you gotta be sure, high throughput means you gotta be fast, and non-flaky means you need to be larger than life, which is like literally meatloaf lyrics for I need a hero. And so this is what I came up with. There's just rep I is hero. The capital I and a little I and a capital E, and don't use a little E, because that's not what you want either. So that'll make more binaries, make case insensitive, suppress errors, don't include the file name in the output, use extended regex, recursive search, and only return the matches, not the whole lines. If you make an alias for this and you're shell profile, it's quite nice to use. And the second thing is because we're processing random stuff from the internet, you're not going to get nice CSV data that you can load up into Excel and just kind of do your pivot table or whatever. There's going to be commas in there. There's going to be double quotes. There's going to be emojis and whatever. But there's kind of a nice little trick where you just use RS, which is Xcode 1E, and use that to separate all your records. Basically, nothing lets you use that as a separator. It is specifically for separating fields. So if you use that instead, you're pretty good to go. I only had, I think, 4 records messed up out of 2.4 million by using this trick. So I highly recommend that, just if you're ever forced to process this kind of weird data. And so then we can get to the fun part, which I'm going to call analysis in quotes. I won't try and say that I like these are going to have like a lot of strong claims about valid statistical inference, but it is basically every Dotfiles repo on the internet, so I think it's a little bit better than 14 anyway. So I'm going to start with a readme.md. So about half of our repositories have a readme, which is kind of a shame, because if you don't know what you're looking at and there's no readme, you're just going to have to kind of guess. So just up front, I am pretty much guessing on what people were trying to do for about half of the repositories. We can run word count or WC on every single README in the sample. So 8,000 of the repos that left have 2 lines in the README, but the mean is 12. There were a couple repos that had 1,900 lines. It turned out they were both forked from dev setup, which is linked there. And then the other large one was int32bit, which was not in English, but had 500 stars on GitHub, which I thought was impressive. Should also mention, there's going to be a lot of links in this talk. Hopefully you all caught that bit.ly link, but I'll just pop back to the beginning. So you can open that up and just be clicking on stuff as I'm talking, because like I'm not going to like be showing you slides and slides full of source code. But if you really want to know like how 9 different people wrote 2 new alias and shell scripts, like you'll at least get the links from there. Pop back up. There we go. Okay. So the next part of the analysis I want to talk about is bootstrapping. So the idea of putting your Dotfiles on GitHub, you know, in some level it's a backup, and you want to be able to get that backup later and then do something so that your home folder is back into the state that it used to be. So there's 2 general approaches that people seem to be using for this. So the first approach is a symlink manager. So if you have your repo full of Dotfiles, a symlink manager will generate a bunch of symlinks from your home folder to inside that repo, and then all of the files are placed in the appropriate places so that when you start up Emacs, it does the right thing. So a popular one is called GNU-Stow. It was originally for managing Perl package symlinks, and I'm sure people still use it for that, but it's become pretty popular for doing this kind of thing with your Dotfiles instead. There's also Homechick. There's 30 more listed on dotfiles.github.com. So what we can do is take that list of 30 dotfile managers out of that list, search all the readmes for those, and do a table, right, to see which ones people are using. The only one that I had to admit was literally called Home, and so that matched a lot of stuff, so threw that one. And we get a distribution that looks like this. So the most popular one by far is called install.sh. Most of those are just kind of random scripts that people have written. I don't think there's an actual manager associated with that. The second most popular is Stow. And then after that is RCM, which I hadn't heard of. But you can kind of see that there's a pretty long tail to these things. But most people tend to rolled over. So the second kind of thing that people use for bootstrapping is what I call the alias approach. And this was originally posted on Hacker News several years ago. And the idea there is to create a bare repository in your home folder and then check files into that. And then to make this not awful to do, you create a shell alias called config that makes that work. So this approach is also used by the YADM, yet another .io manager. So how do we find all of those? So what we can do is we can find all of the shell profile things that match that alias thing, cross-tab them that way. And so this is something that I haven't, I think it's interesting, but I don't know if it's particularly meaningful. So Z shell, it's the biggest match for that, more than bash, which surprised me because Z shell is not default for anything except for Apple just switched it up for in the last release. So I thought that was pretty interesting. So a second thing that I'm particularly interested in would be people referencing Stack Overflow. Many people here were working with computers DSO before Stack Overflow. It was a pretty different experience back then, and like finding what you wanted was a lot harder, and you had to read manuals and hope the person writing the manual had the foresight to put the thing you needed in there, versus Stack Overflow is much more user-friendly. You can search for your question and then find the answer. Like the interaction between Stack Overflow and Google Index is fantastic. So if we were to look at the number of Stack Overflow URLs per repo, so zero is the most common, that's not shown for scaling reasons. About 7,000 repos had exactly one, and then there's a logarithmic kind of heavy tail up until there's some repos that have, call it 700 different Stack Overflow answers inside there, which is a lot. And then if we look at kind of the transpose of that matrix, we can look at the number of repos a given Stack Overflow answer is used in. So again, about 10,000 or so, only used once, but then we have that same kind of shape going all the way to the right. Any thoughts as to why there is 900 people referencing the same Stack Overflow answer in their like nominally versatile configuration files? So here's kind of the top 10, so we can see 2,000 people went to answer 106.8.308, and so on. These are, if you have the bit.ly link, you can click through these later. So the second thing I would point out is that you can see this common number repeated at the end of all of these answers. So when you click the share button in Stack Overflow, it actually appends your user ID to the end of the URL for tracking purposes. So we can see that person 376773 was showing up in a lot of Dotfiles. So who is this person? It's too tall named. He's a JavaScript developer. He does not have a Dotfiles repo. Right? That's easy enough to check because I have all of them. So if we dig into it a little bit, it turns out that there's these Electron apps that are inlining large amounts of code into people's repositories, and they're checking in full plugins. So when you get into it, there's about 1,800 people checking in adding plugins, and then another 2,300 for Visual Studio. So I'm going to go on a little digression. So plugins that are packaged and managed externally probably don't belong in your Dotfiles repo. And there's some other people that have written little rants about that. But if you can make your editor put them in local share, that's the official standard for that, the XDG-based standard. So take that out of the results, and then what's left? So then I thought, okay, well, let's just look at BashRC to see what people are referencing in there, and that's a little bit more in line with what I expected. So you couldn't check if a program exists from a Bash script, or how do you add, are you sure, yes, no, to any command or alias? Also a useful thing. How do I get bash completion to work with aliases? Can be a challenge. So VimRC, I'm a Vim user, so most of my examples will be from that perspective. But I will mention some next up in the next section. So how to map keys for a pop-up menu, very popular. How do I repeat an edit on multiple lines, very popular. So I thought that was kind of interesting. So the thing I was most excited about were the so-called secret scripts, because I think that that's kind of the time savers that people have kind of invented for themselves. So by convention, people keep these in their home folder and the bin folder. Most of the major Linux distributions will add this to your search path automatically. So we can just look in that folder typically for these. So if we do a quick keyword search, a lot of different stuff. Backup is the most popular by far, and then various things for doing things with Git are super, super popular, but maybe this is not meaningful just because I was limited to just looking at Git repos. So I've also highlighted the ones that Danny O'Brien had called out as important back in the day. I think that RSS is not as important. You have more keyword hits for CSVs and for JSON than you do for RSS. Similarly for blog, you only have 37 people that have a blog script versus 72 for Gmail, for example. To-do stuff is still very popular, 451 of those. The top 20 scripts that I found, like I said before, most of these have Git WTF being the most popular, GitHub, and so on through there. And then coming in at number 20 of the top 20 is To-Do, which I thought, all right, that's interesting. So it turns out all of those top 20 are originally from one person, Pullman. So I was able to track this back. So like E2Do, GetWTF, we're all coming from that one person. So that's pretty interesting to me because we've been able to take this random set of files that people were not being particularly diligent about the provenance and then trace it back. So that's some nice kind of library work there. But we also find some other awesome stuff. So there's helpers for extract. So if you don't remember all the magic commands to get whatever working with RAR files versus gzip versus regular zip versus bz2, whatever, extract is a nice script that just kind of abstracts all that away from you and just looks at the file extension and does the great thing. People wrote some stuff for testing colors. There's lots and lots of stuff in my collection of Dotfiles where people do things to make their terminal work with 256 colors or real color or whatever. So color test is a nice one. There's stuff for working with Jira because you don't want to like use the Jira web interface because it's slow. There's scripts for finding your IP address because you can't remember what the ifconf flags are. Lots and lots of interesting stuff. There was also kind of a whole subcategory of navigation that I wanted to call out. So there's FASTD, which is a successor to Z. So apparently, like, people have been working on these things long enough to have like forked projects into their own thing. There are multiple things called the jump. Some of them jump between folders, some of them jump between machines. ISSH, that's fantastic. There's bookmarks implemented for people's shortcuts. There's a lot of other random stuff in there. I won't go through all of these. I particularly like the ones for checking the weather. Depth to SVN was kind of an amusing one to see in there. There are many different ways of managing to-dos. Some of them are aliases, some of them are full-on programs in Python that are like thousands of lines of code. So a lot of variety there. A lot of stuff for working with CSVs. This is like my bread and butter as a data scientist, so I was happy to kind of find these things. CSV to SQLite, fantastic. CSV to JSON, also fantastic. Build monk history to CSV.rb, that sounds like super useful. Analyze CSV and so on. Lots of scripts around AWS, which you have to use a lot, so setting up your tokens and your roles and all that stuff is very nice for me to kind of find other people who have already figured that out. So kind of the final thing that I wanted to analyze was the commit history itself. So all of these were in Git, so every single change has been versioned, hopefully with a useful comment. So each commit has an author, a timestamp, and a message, but yeah, this is Steve Losh, who has appeared in all four of the data sets I had. So he was on Bitbucket, and GitLab, and GitHub, and and Source Hut. He's also written a bunch of stuff about him. He says, my Dotfiles are a commit message, circus slash wasteland. But you should not go that. It seems like it's that way for pretty much everyone. So this is the total number of commits over time in the data set. Green being GitHub, so that's by far the largest. And we've crossed 2 million commits as of 2019, which is kind of amazing. The oldest, non-obviously corrupt commits, so there's a bunch of commits that are tagged as 1970, but that's just because of when the Unix timestamp epoch starts. So throw those out, and we have this guy, ST Robert Head, created one of these in 1998. It contained one file, which was .logout, which runs when you log out, and contained the command clear, which clears your screen. Interesting place to start for the very first thing in all of the history I can find. This is the total number of active repos, so we can see, 2019 isn't finished yet, so that's why there's that drop there, but we are having this kind of exponential growth. We'll probably have over 20,000 people actively contributing.
Yeah? How do you define active in this graph?
As a commit in that year.
Okay, all right.
Yeah. So this is the total number of unique repos by their last update. So this is a slightly different view of that. It has that same kind of exponential growth shape as well. This one is the log scale, unfortunately, of the number of weeks active. So over there we can see kind of a bimodal distribution. There is a certain group of people that are only active for one to three days. Generally, and then they never touch this thing again. And then there's the bigger group of people that actually like keep working with it for between 1 week and you know whatever 5 is in log 10. Number of commits per week. So I think this is also interesting to think about how often are people updating these things or checking them in. Again, it's log scale so that we can actually fit it on the screen. One is the most common, so if you are committing one time a week to your Dotfiles repo, that would be the typical thing. There are people that are doing 100, 1,000 commits per week, but I don't know what they're up to. And then similarly, there's people that are doing way less than that. This is just the same thing, just as box plots, like box plots, use them all the time. And here we can see that tilde-git people are committing quite a bit faster, but that's small sample size. There's only 29 of them. GitLab, people are using a little bit more. GitHub are using a little bit less. Bitbucket's kind of in the middle, but all very, very close to that one per. This is the number of merge commits per repo, which I thought would be interesting. So who are these people that are doing PRs to their doc files and then merging them in? Not a lot of them, so zero is 60,000 repos out of the 100, but that means that there's 40,000 that are, which very much surprised me. So there is some literature about using different branches for different machines you've had. I think that's an interesting idea, but it still seems pretty bespoke. In terms of file names in the index, readme.md is the most common, package.json and index.js are the next most common. And again, this goes back to people doing the Electron plugins inside there. And then .gitignore is the next most. And using the .gitignore is fantastic. This is the correlation of a bunch of different files that people use. So I've kind of drilled into these. So you can see a bunch of snippet files are all highly correlated. WGET and curl are positively correlated. So if you use one, you're likely to use the other two. Interesting. Git.zsh and Jira, highly correlated. Bunch of Vim themes, highly correlated. Ruby stuff goes together. Travis.yaml and makefiles go together. This is a biplot. So if you were to factor that correlation matrix into orthogonal dimensions, we can see what directions in the multi-dimensional space the different config files are going. So we can see that bash and Z shell are pointing in opposite directions in the second major dimension. And in the first one, tmux get ignored, get configured, all kind of government out of the way. We look at the other dimensions, again, we still have the bash versus Z-shell, but then we get vimrc versus get ignored. I haven't quite figured that out, but tmux is kind of loading up with vim, which I think makes sense, because Emacs has a terminal inside it, so why would you need a tmux? These are just cross tabs and plots of those correlations. I would call out these chi-squares that we're getting are about 100 times higher than you would see in like intro to stats, or if you were like testing on lab rats or something like that. But that's just because we have a lot of data. So for the Vim stuff specifically, I'm almost out of time, but what you can do is you can pull out every single setting that every single VimRC has, split them out that way and count them up. So turning on line numbers is by far the most popular thing, which is interesting. There is some disagreement about tabs versus spaces and whether tabs should be two spaces or four spaces. I would also call out that there's defaults.vim, which is the dot files for the person that wrote Vim, and I've highlighted the ones that overlap with kind of the community norms, I guess. So I think this is super interesting. So it's like, if everyone is doing these things, maybe that should just be the default in Vim, not. It seems reasonable to turn on the line numbers. And then kind of to wrap up, like, I think social configuration is a thing, I don't know. These electron apps are becoming the new normal. It seems like a lot of people are using them. From my perspective, analyzing the data doesn't matter which hosting you choose, that's kind of up to you. Finding original sources, if you see something, then tracking it back is very difficult. People are copy-pasting all these things instead of sending each other patches, which is fine, but sometimes you do get lucky, like that Stack Overflow stuff that let me figure out who's that guy. And then the secret scripts, you know, they're kind of a moving target. They're moving away from blogs and RSS, and they're moving towards JSON and cloud stuff, I would say, qualitatively. My recommendations are use a .file manager or write an install.sh, add a README, link back to yourself. So you can include URLs in file headers or refer stuff like that. That way when other people copy-paste it, maybe there's a little bit of a break. Also some Git practices, use the thing. So if you're checking in once per week, that's a good rule. Use Git ignore so that you don't accidentally check in all your Electron plugins or your compiled Python program, stuff like that. Maybe try out using different branches on different machines so that you can merge across them. And that's it. So I think we have a little bit of time for Q&A. Yeah.
I was going to ask you, did you see anything on a year-to-year basis? So for example, maybe Z shells became popular from 2015, and maybe Bash RC has been growing or reducing over time. Was it on a year basis?
Yeah, so I think that data would be in the collection. I didn't have time to look at individual files over time. But yeah, that'd be an interesting thing.
So it'd be interesting to kind of even see if naming conventions have changed. Like people may not be using to-dos anymore.
Right.
Maybe a really popular back in the day and now people don't use it.
Right. And I mean, it's hard to say, because this is, again, just a proxy for actual usage. If you wanted to go one step further, if somehow you could get people's history files, if they were sharing those also, then you could look at like the empirical usage instead of the configuration. Other questions?
I wrote my own if you don't.
Okay, good.
I'd like that you explain how you got all the data that you got, or at least how you got all the dot file with this. Is the part of the script that you use to generate the reports about the query after data that you actually like, process? Is that available anywhere?
Yeah, if you're interested in the R scripts, I can share them. They're pretty messy. But
I don't know R also. Amazing.
Okay, yeah, sure. A lot of it's just your kind of standard group by aggregate and then drop it through blocking software. Yeah.
I was wondering, you mentioned history. I was wondering if you did any checking, like you said, maybe two files aren't important anymore, but in the history, like looking at the file names and then how often they're actually committed to, right? Like, in theory, if I'm still using a script, then I might see changing it over time.
Mm-hmm.
Did you look at any, like, you know, what thing? things, what files got stuck in, like on the first commit versus things were getting edited like every week? And what was getting edited every week? What was changing every week and they're committing every week?
Yeah, so didn't get to that either. But again, like it's in there. If you're super interested in looking at the data set, I can send you a link so that you don't have to like deal with GitHub's rate limit for a month or whatever. I mentioned that GitHub suggests it's only running 500 repos an hour, so it takes a couple weeks in order to assemble the entire data set. Couple other questions. You can look at RMS's computing setup. There's also a org mode implementation of literate Dotfiles that I found super amusing, and then there's a bunch of stuff on Hacker News that's pretty interesting. What else? How does Batch start up? That guy has a good explanation. That's why there are so many different types of profile files in this data set. About me, I'm a Washburn CS grad. I'm a data science and machine learning consultant, technically. I'm a trained statistician. And I'm an open source contributor. There's my GitHub. You can go in there and star all my random projects about hooking R up to Amazon and Athena or whatever. This is what I use. Also, before you start doing this, check your hard drives. Because even if it seems like they're working fine, like writing, they can still be messed up on reading, so that was not fun. Copy aliases, those are all pretty standard, but my favorite is more equals less. What else would be interesting? Yes?
Analyzing for logging credentials, I saw a lot of jumps, SSH, and stuff like that.
Yeah, so I specifically didn't look for people taking passwords or something like that. Like, I don't even want to know. But yeah, that's probably in there. I think I made that mistake myself. And you have to like go in and figure out how to edit the data history or whatever. Yeah. Anything else? All right, well, thank you all very much.